Good morning, church. God is good. Yes, sir. Amen. Amen. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Let's get started with our service. Stand by for the morning announcements.
Save the date for the 45th New Life Church anniversary. This special semi-formal celebration dinner will be held on Sunday, May 19th from 2 p.m. to 5 p.m. at the Holiday Inn in Newport News. Meet a representative in the vestibule after the morning service to acquire your tickets or receive additional information. The New Life Women's Ministry is celebrating fathers this year with a special Father's Day cookout. Ladies, to make this endeavor a success, we need your assistance in various areas and activities. Meet a representative in the vestibule immediately following the morning service. A list of activities will be provided upon sign-up. Additionally, registration is needed for fathers and men who will be attending, as it is vital for a head count and food preparations. Watch the bulletin as more information is forthcoming.
If this is your first time visiting with New Life Church, we will not ask you to say anything. We would like for you just to stand, and we're going to give you a New Life Church warm welcome. If this is your first time, amen. 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 Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for taking time out your busy schedule to fellowship with us this morning. And we pray that the Lord will continue blessing you and giving you all the glory and all the honor. Amen. 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 Saints, yes, I want to emphasize an announcement that we had on the screen this morning. And it was about the Father's Day cookout. This cookout, saints, is for New Life Church men and the families. So it's for the members of New Life Church and their families. It's not just a men's cookout, but it's a cookout for the men and the families. If you're a member of New Life Church, it's for you. So don't forget to put that on your calendar, save the date for that. We want to emphasize this cookout is for the family of New Life Church. One other announcement I want to make in addition to that is our bulletin board that's outside of the sanctuary. The bulletin board has a lot of stuff that's going on in our community. We just don't put the stuff on the bulletin board for our health. It's for you to be aware of what's going on in our community. Amen? And you'll find those bulletin boards when you go out to the sanctuary, and another one is, I think it's outside the church office. Is that right? The bulletin board outside the security office? Yeah, it's outside the security office, and it's another one outside of the sanctuary. I forgot last Sunday to acknowledge April's birthdays. If April is your birthday month, please stand. Amen. 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 I know there's a few people in the house that have birthdays in April. Matter of fact, today is my baby's birthday, my wife's birthday. So when you see her, give her a big hug and say, happy birthday. And happy birthday to all of the saints that was born in the month of April. If April is your anniversary, please stand. All right then. All right. All right. All right. Thank you so much. Anniversaries are important. The word says a man that finds a wife finds a good thing. So I'm gonna say that again. A man that finds a wife finds a what? A good thing. So happy anniversary to you. And I pray that you will continue celebrating your anniversary in many, many more years to come. One other quick announcement I would like to make is Sister Banks in the house this morning? Sister Minister Banks, she in the house this morning? Okay, when you see her, pass. If you would like to become a member, we would like to get a list of names so we can make sure you get set up with our first principles class. So pass that on to someone that may not be here, or if you're here to see Sister Cheryl Banks, or if you can't find her, we're going to ask you to contact the church office. For those that would like to become a member, you have to go through our first principal class and call the church office and see Sister Michelle Kearney for first principles. Amen? Amen. Amen. You ready to serve God today? You ready to give God all the glory and the honor he's due? Before we do, let's take a look at a scripture I would like to share with you this morning. And the scripture is found in Psalms 68, 19 through 20. Psalm 68, 19 to 20 says, "Praise be to the Lord, to God our Savior, who daily bears our burdens," Selah. "Our God is a God who saves. From the sovereign Lord comes escape from death." I want to read that again because I want you to concentrate on what David is saying in Psalms. It says, "Praise be to the Lord, to God our Savior, who daily bears our burdens," Selah. "Our God is a God who saves. From the sovereign Lord comes escape from death." When you gave your life to Christ, you're no longer bound to hell. You're going to be with God forever and ever and ever and ever. So it's a blessing. This is what salvation, this is what witnessing, this is what it means to give your life to Christ. It's all about Christ dying on the cross for you, for us. Amen? So let us stand and pray before we get started with our service. Heavenly Father, we give you the honor. We give you the praise. We give you the glory, Lord God, for it all. Father God, we don't look to the left or to the right. We look to you from where our help comes from. So Father, when we gave our life to Christ, it's because we know that you died and you was raised again on the third day. So we thank you, Father. We thank you, Lord God, for saving our souls. We thank you, Lord God, for sending your son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for us. So we give you the honor, we give you the glory for it all, Lord God. And today, Lord God, we're asking the Holy Spirit to minister to those that have not given their life to you, whether they're at home or in the sanctuary this morning. So today, we honor you, Father. We give you the glory, we give you the praise, in and all. In the matchless name of Jesus Christ, amen.
When you're lonely and your heart is filled with despair, just remember God cares.
God cares for you.
And when you're in doubt and you can't find a way out, he will see you through. Yes, he
see
will.
See you through. See you through.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Hallelujah, Lord, we'll forever worship you, oh God. Well, you're worthy of our worship, amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah for you. You are a consuming fire. Hallelujah. We invite you now, Lord, to refine the spiritual fire. Hallelujah. Desire.
You're my heart's desire.
And I love you dearly, Lord.
And I love you dearly, dearly, Lord.
You're my meditation.
Oh,
so worthy, Jesus. You're so worthy, God. God, you're so worthy. You're so worthy. Oh, you're so worthy, Lord. You're so worthy, God. You're so worthy, Lord. You're so worthy. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, glory. Oh, God. Oh, God, we praise you. Oh, we honor you, Lord. You're such a good God. We praise you. We worship you, Lord. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise. Hallelujah, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise you, praise you, praise you. Father, we choose to seek your face because you are the way, the truth, and the life. We choose to seek you, God, because you said if we seek you, we will find you. And you said in your word that you would hold no good thing from them that walk upright before you. So we know that we have possession of the good things, oh God, because you said you won't withhold them if we walk upright. See, God, there's promises in your word, God, but there's conditions. But once we meet that condition, God, you got to do what you said you're going to do because you're God that doesn't lie. You don't make broken promises. You're going to do what you said you would do. And you just want us to get to a place that will obey you and take heed to your word and to your promise. Not so much what I say today, God, but what the Holy Spirit speaks through. Give us ears to hear, hearts to receive. What thus saith the Lord our God. Amen. Amen. Oh, I'm not a preacher, but I've been walking with God for 53 years, so I know a little something, something. Just know a little something. And ever since Wednesday, when Pastor called me, I've been in this Bible, going through scriptures, going over scriptures, until it's like the Holy Spirit says, sit down, girl. And I just want to talk to you today. Like I said, I'm not a preacher. And I'm just going to share with you what God has put on my heart. I have a question. Matter of fact, I have a couple of questions. And one of my questions is, can you just raise your hand if somebody shared the gospel of Jesus Christ with you and it caused your life to change? Can you just raise your hand? Anybody happen that to happen? Okay, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Somebody told you about Jesus. Amen. Amen. So
Where's Elder Pittman? I wanted to get the mic, but I needed somebody to answer this. I praise the Lord for you, Herb. Come in. I just want to thank God for Rob. Rob didn't know I was going to speak today, but yesterday when we were downtown at OBT, he prayed for me. He didn't even know what he was praying. Bless his soul, Jesus. I just need a mic. I want to ask a question, and I want you to take the mic to whoever's going to answer it for me. Why? My question is, and I need somebody to answer it. Why do you think Jesus died for you? Two people. Anybody? Oh, Charlie Brown. That's my child. Of course, she's going to answer.
Good morning, praise Lord, for the remission of our sins.
Okay. Anybody else? Back in the back, her. Amen. So why did he save us? What was the purpose and what was the plan for salvation, for him to save us? Go ahead.
He died because he loved us.
Amen. John 3:16. Amen. Okay, Herb, I'm not going to make you run around anymore, my brother. I love you. Amen. So, we know that somebody shared the gospel of Jesus Christ with us that caused our lives to change. Some of you might have a different story. Maybe you was in the bed and the Holy Spirit spoke to you, brought you up. But whatever it was, somebody told you about Jesus Christ. And you made a decision that you were going to serve him. Now, in serving Christ, you know, there's benefits of being saved. But there's also some instructions that Jesus left for us to do. And so we got to follow instructions. That's it and that's all. So what I'm going to talk to you about this morning is evangelism. When somebody came to you and shared the gospel of Jesus Christ with you, that caused your life to change. And because your life changed, then what you should do once your life changed, you wanted to tell somebody. I remember the time when I gave my life to the Lord. Oh my God. Every time the church, I was knocking on the door, the church was closed, and I was still knocking on the door. I was so on fire for Jesus, I couldn't stand myself. But I'm telling you that a cooling off time came. But how many of us know that there should never be a cooling off when it comes to the things of Christ? Because when we ask God to do stuff for us, we don't want him to cool off, do we? We want him to just come on with it, Jesus. I need this right now. Come on, get it. But when it comes to us, it's a cooling off time. We get slack in praying, slack in seeking the Lord, not sharing others about the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. He just didn't save us to be saved, y'all. That was a purpose and a plan. Do you know he left the beauty and the ray of heaven to come down? He had a crown. He had everything up in heaven. This wasn't his home down here. But yet he came and he gave up everything, even his life, so we could have life. Some of us won't get out of our beautiful houses to go downtown to tell somebody that you love them. I'm not talking about everybody, but there's some people that once they get to where they think that they are, they forget about God and the promises that he told us. We want all the things that God offers us, but when he said, now I want you to go, somebody say go. He told us to go.
But we get caught up. We get caught up in our in what we're doing. We get caught up in our home, and we get caught up in our relationships. And we kind of cool off for the things of God. Don't you think that grieves him? I think it does, because I've had to repent a whole lot of times because I can't focus on y'all. I got to focus on Sister Linda, because Sister Linda messes up a lot. So I have to focus on me. And you know, every time somebody do something to me and I go to God with God, they said this and said that and such and such and such and such. You know what God does? He begins to show me. Okay, Sister Soldier, let me show you. And so it's easy for us to see the faults of each other. But come and ask God. Double dare you to ask God to show you yourself. To get yourself naked before the Lord and watch what come up. It's going to be stinking and it's going to be nasty. Why? Because we are not doing what he's called us to do in this hour. Some of us are comfortable. I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to those that are comfortable, that are uncomfortable, that know that it's more to God than what you got. And you want some more and some more and some more and some more. That's who I'm talking to. I don't know how many of you know this, but you know, on the third and the fourth Saturday of each month, we go to OBT is open for evangelism. We go down, we give food to the people, and we pray for them. And on Fridays we have prayer here. On Wednesday we have prayer here. And so keep those that are doing this, keep doing it, because that pleases the Lord. So in other words, I'm trying to tell you, I'm trying to encourage you this morning. It might not sound like it, but I'm here to encourage you. I really am. To encourage you to keep on doing what you know God has called you to do. I look at King back there on the sound system. He's a necessary part of the body. King, aren't you necessary? Amen. He's necessary. The choir, oh, they're gone. But the choir, they're necessary. They're a necessary part of the body. They're a necessary part. I look at my pastor and his wife, and he prays for you guys. They both pray for us. We need their prayers. I believe with all my heart, if Constance and Pastor Arthur have not prayed for us, a lot of us wouldn't be here right now. I believe that with all my heart. Why? Because that's what they do. That's what they do. There's some people right here in this church. I'm not going to call her name. She'll be mad if I do. But she's quiet. She's not, half of y'all probably don't even know who she is. Probably don't even know her name. But she's powerful. She's a powerful sister. And she goes every second and fourth Saturday, and she goes down to OBT. And she rolls up her sleeves and she goes to work. That baby don't miss a beat. Now sometimes she might get upset, but she keeps coming. There's another sister that sits out in front of OBT, and you know what she does? Sits in her car and calls people. Some of them hang up on her, some might cuss her out, but she keeps going and she keeps doing it. The women that come here and pray on Fridays, and the ones that come on Wednesday, they probably tired, bones ache, but what? They keep coming. I'm just encouraging you all, whatever you're doing, you're necessary to this church, to the body of Christ. The instruments, you know, I had to call it Arcelia. Oh my God. Everywhere I go, they always say, do you know Arcelia Simmons? Do you know Arcelia Simmons? Why? Because the girl is impacting people's lives. Why ain't he calling her name? The girl's impacting lives. Don't you think that's what Jesus, when he came to this earth, he didn't go to the big cathedrals and the temples. He went down to the people that needed him. The people in the cathedrals, the temples, they needed him too, but they didn't realize they needed him. And he began to share his love with them. And that's why I want to encourage y'all today, whatever you're doing. I remember Denise, we were down a few years back when Jerry was still living. We went out to put some flyers out in the neighborhood. And I hadn't heard from my granddaughter, and I know 3 or 4 years, she just cut herself off from everybody, my oldest granddaughter. And so when we went down to OBT, all of a sudden my phone rang, and it was my granddaughter. I bust out crying, she was crying, I was crying, we was all to pieces. And when me and Denise was walking down the street, after I talked to her and everything, and we went out to put out flyers, the Lord spoke to me and he said, "Daughter, if you take care of my business, I'll take care of your business." So what I'm saying to you, take care of God's business. There's some business down here for us to do. We cannot, time is too short for us not to know. Maybe you don't know what you're supposed to do. But before you leave here today, you need to find out, you need to cry out. What the word says, seek his face. Find out what God has called you to do and do it. And do it well. And do it well. Barbara Wallace, another one. That girl, she, awesome. You don't see her doing a whole lot of stuff up in here, but she is powerful downtown. Yeah. Everybody know her. Why? Because she's moving in the things of God. She's moving in the things of God. And you know the one that I told you that was powerful down there that don't want me? I better not call her name. But I remember when I went to the jail. I worked in the jail for 13 years, and I felt burned out. But you know, I called on two sisters that were in this church. And they came to that jail and helped me. And I was able to sit down for a minute. It was a blessing. They didn't have to. But God led them by his spirit. I'm encouraging you today because you know why? God encourages me all the time. There's many times I don't want to go. I don't want to go do nothing. My bones hurt. I'm tired. I'm old. I tell God that all the time. But you know what he tells me? Can't put my hands to the plow and look back. I got to keep on going. So I'm just encouraging each and every one of you. That's why I told you, I'm not a preacher. But I do want to go to the scripture. The scripture is, let me put my glasses on because I know I can't see without them. But evangelism, the importance of spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ. We all know that's so important. We got to tell somebody, y'all. How they going to know if you don't tell them? Thank you, Jesus. Matthew 28. Go. Somebody say go.
Go.
Ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the ends of the world. And saying that, we just have a little bit of history lessons. That Bishop Lewis, let me keep my glasses on so I can see. Bishop Lewis started Operation Breaking Through. Did y'all know that? Yes. And he was recognized by President H.W. Bush, and it was called the Points of Light Awards. That was 1,000 points of light. George W. Bush Points of Light Awards honored individuals who demonstrated the transformation power of service and who are driven significant and sustained impact
through their everyday actions and words that lighted the path for others. Because of that, what we were doing on Temple Lane, that's what got the church recognized. Why? Because we were all about the Father's business. We had jobs and everything, but you know what we did? Pastor Rogers, he went door to door getting people's names and addresses. We were in Chantilly, Woodsum, everywhere, all around where Temple Lane, where the church was. We were going out. Pastor told us, he always told us that if we could just get one soul a year, you know what? If you just ask somebody to give their life to the Lord, what kind of an impact that would be? What kind of an impact that would be? Just one. And we were out there, and the church got packed and jammed. We had to go to two services. God was blessing us for what we were doing for him. He said, I will not withhold any good thing from them that walk upright. We were out sharing this gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. We were over in the crackhead areas. We were everywhere. And so some of y'all are going to say, well, you know, things are like that and that. Not like that now. It's terrible. It's scary. It's worse out there now. But we serve the same God. He ain't changed. We serve the exact same God. Do you think the same God that did it over there can't do it over here? Hello. He's the same God. Who covered us while we were out there in them streets where them people, we might have walked up on somebody smoking weed, doing a pipe. No, we just went because we went by faith. We moved. The bishop said, come on, this is what God told us to do, and this is what we're going to do. And as we moved in what God told us to do, God blessed. Now, I'm not going to focus on nobody here. I'm going to focus on Sister Linda. So when God blessed us to move over here, we had this neighborhood back here that was fighting us like the devil because they didn't want this church here. But little do they know that so many prayers have been up to on their houses, their doors, and everything. We're going to continue to pray for them, you know, because this is God's will, not our will, not New Life's will. This was the will of God. And as we did what he wanted us to do, he blessed us. I'm not saying he's not blessing us now, because he is. There's in the book of Revelation, when John was caught up and Jesus showed him, gave him seven letters for seven churches. I just, food for thought. If God had to write us a letter today for New Life Church, what do you think it would say? It's just food for thought. Would he show us what we need to improve at? Would he show us what we're doing good at? I think if we asked him, he would show us what we need to do. So I'm really here to encourage each and every one of you that whatever he told us to go, he told us to go. And that's what we need to do. I know many of you have come and walked with me, prayer walk with me. I thank God for you. There's many that came downtown Newport News. I thank God for you too. I thank God for everybody who's doing something in the body of Christ. Because we need something needs to be done. Each and every one of us should be responsible for at least one soul. Bishop always say, can you just give me one? Can you just give me one? Because just think. A lady introduced me to Christ. And because of that lady, I was able to go to the jail and share the gospel. I was able to go to the prisons and share the gospel. I was able to go to CBN and talk to those people on the phone and share the gospel. So I'm telling you, giving your life to the Lord and sharing this gospel, just not just being saved, saints. It's okay, yes, good. I'm glad you're saved, filled with the Holy Spirit. Sanctified, filled. That's fine. But God is telling us to go, saints. He's telling us to go. And if we don't go, who's going to go? Who going? It's so many people out here telling lies. Who's going to go tell the truth if it ain't the saints of God? So my prayer, that whatever God has you doing, keep on doing it. Don't get weary in well doing. Many times God has to encourage me because I'm not very strong. And I keep bringing up this sister that's strong. She's so quiet. She's sitting in the back. She don't hardly say nothing. But this girl is so powerful. I love her. But she's available to God. Just be available to God. Whatever the choir, it's not easy for the choir to come. I was in the choir, trying to rush, trying to get your kids food fixed, breakfast in the morning, trying to get your robe all messed up, all twisted all around and everything, and you trying to get here to be in the choir stand at a certain time, you got to be in the choir stand at a certain time. That won't easy. Two things Bishop Lewis shared with us, and I took it personal. One was a story of, he had two dreams. One dream was about some people that came to the church. Another church came and was meeting with us. And some people came into the edifice. And they didn't look good. They didn't smell good. But we kind of shunned them. This was happening in the dream. We kind of shunned them, but the other group of people embraced them. And so after the service, those people went with those people that showed them love and embraced them. And the other dream he had was, there was this big 18-wheeler in the mud. With big old 18-wheeler, but it couldn't move. It was stuck. The wheels just kept moving, but it wasn't going nowhere. Now, I'm not saying that. I took it personal. Because the Lord showed me that I had a religious spirit. See, sometimes you can get caught up. You think you're so holy till you ain't no earthly good. You know, I was one of them. You know, so religious, so heavenly bound, you ain't no earthly good. So I had to repent. And then with the 18-wheeler in the mud, well, just because you're in the choir and just because God uses you in some of the gifts of the spirit, you think this is all you're supposed to do? No, go. That's why I go. Because it's not enough. I have to tell somebody about this man, Jesus, that cleansed me, delivered me, set me free. Why? Because I want everybody else to be delivered. I want everybody else set free. One more thing, and I'm gonna sit down. You know, me and my daughter sometimes have a conversation. And in our conversations, they would talk about cheating men. And they would say, oh, all men cheat, something. But you know what I would say? I couldn't talk for anybody else. But I would always say that my daughter right there, I don't care what y'all say, God himself would have to tell me that my pastor ever cheated on his wife. Nobody could ever tell me that. My head would be on a chopping block behind that. You know why? Because I watch him. I keep my good eye on him. And it's not so much that the love he has for Constance is so deep and so strong. No, it's the love for God in him. That's so deep and so strong in him. I see it many times at funerals. These women had their legs hacked open, dressed all up and stuff. And pastor, I'd be praying for him. He'd be trying to, he'd be in the Bible. He'd make sure he keep his head down and he keep it moving. Because you know, because God has delivered him in that area. And he knows he's not going to give place to the devil. And that's what we got to do. We have to do what God wants us to do in this hour. It's too much going on. The hour is too late for us to just be doing nothing. Amen. So maybe God didn't call you to go to OBT. Maybe he didn't call you to prayer walk. Maybe he didn't call you to whatever. even I'm thinking about Michelle, that she answers the phone. Sister Michelle, she answers the phone. She's evangelizing all day long. And so I'm saying, you don't, when I'm saying go, whatever God has called you, commissioned you to do, you need to get up and do it well. God's, there's benefits. There's benefits in serving God. And God used with me for almost 30 years. I worked for Sears and Roebuck, and I sold jewelry. And they taught us a hook when we first got there. And the hook was, especially, we sold gold, and we sold silver, and we sold gemstones, and we sold diamonds. But the focus was, where the money was the diamonds. So our concentration was always on the diamonds, the clarity, the cut, and the color. They called it a hook, to hook the customer in, to tell them, to give them the benefits of the diamond, and then you let the cost be the last thing you tell them, so you won't turn them off. You tell them about all the benefits of it first. Then at the end, you tell them the cost. So over these years, God has used that analogy for me. When I went to the jail, when I went downtown, soup truck, all of that, God can show you how to witness. He can show you. A lot of times when people come to the door, they might have low cleavage dresses. Their dress might be up. Their pants might be hanging down. Might have a hat on. All kind of stuff. You don't know what's coming through the door. You don't. But whatever is coming through the door, we must illustrate, demonstrate love at all times. At all times, we must demonstrate the love of God. We have to. Because love is what, I was a wretch undone. You ought to see, I was a hot mess. If they put me out, they would have put me out of the church if they seen where I was coming. But I ain't know no better. The closer I got to God, the more I let my dresses come down. The more the cleavage got covered up, the closer, not I got to people, but the closer I got to God. Do you hear me? The closer I got to God, God changed things. Sometimes it's not for us to tell them, oh, your stuff, that. Now, sometimes maybe God will tell you to do that. But you got to catch a fish first before you clean them up. I ain't never seen nobody try to clean up a fish in the water while it's swimming around. I ain't seen it. I ain't never seen it. You gotta catch them first. And we need, because the way we were taught, old school, you shouldn't, we gotta be this. But yes, eventually, but until God tells you to share that part of that with that person, you don't know what they're going through. You don't see their heart. You don't know what's going on. But they understand love. He told me that one time downtown Newport News. Daughters, don't go there down there trying to tell these people Genesis to Revelation. They're not going to understand that. But they understand love. And that's what I do. Not because of Melinda now. Don't get it twisted. Because of God teaching me. Even in the jail, being locked up with them girls, oh, scared to death. Oh, my God. Murderers in there. Oh, Lord, have mercy. And the same God that covered me over there, he covers me downtown. That same God that covers me downtown covers me when I go prayer walking. The same God that covers me when I do all that, when I go to the nursing home, he covers us. We don't have to be afraid. He didn't give us a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. So if he did that, did he tell the truth or did he lie? I believe he told the truth. I believe everything he said myself. I don't know about y'all. And so I have to be led by his spirit and not by this flesh. Flesh don't want to do nothing. I'm telling you right now. My belly hungry. I'm ready to eat. But if God tells me to go, no, you got to go so-and-so. Guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to fuss a minute, but I'm going to just do what he said. I'm not perfect. I don't always do what God tells me, but I know I'm going to get a beating. Y'all going to get a beating too if you don't do what he tells you to do, because he loves you. He chastens those that he loves. And so I just want to encourage you, whatever you're doing in the body of Christ. The ushers, they're so important. They're the first person people see. So let's pray for each other. And stop hurting each other with our tongues. We do that a lot with our tongues. And see, once your words get out, you can't take them back. So you can just ask God to just help you so we won't keep wounding each other. The devil does enough stuff as it is for us doing it to each other. So I'm saying that we need to just pray and ask the Lord, what would he have you to do in this hour? Is he telling you, we got places set up for you to go and witness to people? If you feel like doing that, or just ask the Lord. He came down here and got 12 disciples. Someone was out fishing. He said, come on with me and I'll make you fishers of men. Don't you think he'll do the same thing with us? He'll make us fishers of men? All we got to do is follow him and he'll make us fishers of men. So I said, once the Holy Spirit stops, I'm going to stop. And I just want to praise the Lord. I just thank y'all for listening to me. But I just want to ask you, if there's anybody here that don't know what God called you to do, if you're not sure what God called you to do, then we need to pray. We need to pray that God would make it clear and precise what he would have you to do. He loves us, and he loves the world. He died for all of us. The drug addict, the alcohol, the homosexual. Pastor Rogers told us 2 Sundays ago. He said, look, y'all, homosexuality is not going to send you to hell. Lesbianism not going to send you to hell. Alcohol and cigarettes not going to send you to hell. What's going to send you to hell is when you reject Jesus Christ as your Lord and as your Savior. And that's what's going to take us to hell, y'all. So you have the opportunity to share this gospel in the grocery store, in the restaurant, wherever you are. You don't have to walk in fear to approach. Yes, somebody probably might cuss you out, tell you off. What did they do to Jesus? They not only did that, they killed him. They didn't just cuss him, they killed Jesus. So what in the world are we upset or afraid about because somebody said, I don't want to hear that? You know how many times I heard that? But we have an obligation not just to be saved, but to go. Somebody say go. Amen. So like I said, when the Holy Spirit stop, I'm going to stop. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Ooh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Father, I just thank you, Father, for my brothers and sisters in Christ. I love them, oh God. And there's nothing they can do about it. So, Father, not what I said, but what God, you spoke through me. I ask you, Lord, in the name of your son, Jesus, just as you encourage me, God, if there's somebody needs encouragement today, Lord, that might feel weary and well-doing, that they just don't want to keep on going, but God, by the power of your Holy Spirit, touch them right now, Lord. Encourage their hearts to go on. No matter what's going on in this world, Lord, you are in control. And you're going to have the last say. Thank you for my brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, that we will continue to upgrade each other. Upgird each other in truth, oh God. That we will no longer speak things that hurt and damage. But we'll let the love of God flow from heart to heart and breast to breast. It only takes 2.5 seconds to say, Lord, as we go out of our houses in the morning, Father, if there's anybody that I need to tell them about you, God, let them come in my pathway, or let me go where I need to go, God, so I can share this gospel. We're all evangelists. That you call us all to do that. You said go. And God, if they didn't hear anything else, Lord, today, let them know that they need to go. Wherever it is they need to go, they need to go. But with clarity and with precision, Father, show them where you would have them to go, God. And let them not be weary in well-doing. Father, we thank you. We give you glory. We give you honor. And we give you praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Pastor.
Amen, church. I just have one quick thing that I want to share with you concerning the New Life Church, because I think you really need to hear this and you really need to know it. Our main focus is not to fill this church up. That's not our main focus. Our main focus is to reach souls for the kingdom of God. Some people are so focused on getting membership built up, but they don't care about the souls of the people. And they do any and everything that they have to do to try to get a whole lot of members in their church. And some are everything goes on in those assemblies because their main focus on, if we get a lot of people, that means we're successful. No. You are successful when you are doing what God say do. Now hear me, do we want people to come? Sure we do. But the thing is, if we go out into the vineyard, if we do what God wants us to do, he's going to bring people. He will bring people in. And when God brings people in, it might not be the kind of people that we always think he's going to bring. They're going to be people with needs. They're going to be people who we look at and want to take them back outside. Some of them going to be prestigious people. They're going to be people going to come that got money. People going to come that ain't got no money. People going to come with mental illness. All kinds of things, because this is where they can get healed. So our main interest is doing what God said do. Look out and see the fields. They're white and they're ready for harvest. You know, let me give you this scenario. We know that God said if we give, he'll give it back to us. We know he said he'll open the windows of heaven and pour us out a blessing, you know, we don't have room to receive it. See, if we give, he'll give it back to us. Good measures pressed down, shaken together, running over, so he calls men to give back to our bosom. But we don't give to get. You have to understand that. We give to be obedient to God. But because God honors his word, he'll give it back to you. That's how it works. You don't tell people, oh, you give to God, he going to do this and he going to do that. No, that's not the reason why we give. That's not the reason why we witness. We are not promoting New Life Church. I want you to understand that. We're not out here promoting New Life Church. We're out here winning souls to Jesus. God will lead them to where he wants them to go. We have so many people who so much promoting their church so much that they're forgetting about sharing Christ. And that's the most important thing. Because after they get saved, it doesn't matter where they go as long as they go to a place that can teach them the whole truth. And somebody that's going to nurture them and make them disciples, teach them how to be disciples of Christ. So we're not all about just trying to get people in here, trying to get people. We need to get more people in church. We need to get more people in the church. People change their music. People adopt the ways of the world to try to get the world to come into the church. I mean, they do some of everything to try to just get people in. But what happened to those people once they're in there? And what happened to the people that's there now? Are they being fed? Are they being encouraged like they was today? Are they being encouraged to do what God say do? Because our responsibility is to make sure that you are built up and strengthened and encouraged and equipped to do the work of the ministry. That's our main goal. That's our main thing. That's why we exist. So that's why we put so much emphasis on souls. And that's why we make sure that when we have somebody up here, that they're bringing you the pure, true gospel, uncompromised gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what it's all about. So we want you to be focused on what God has. And Sister Linda spoke, and the thing that kept coming to my mind was just do it, just do it, just do it. Because we know what to do. We know, but we got to do it. And it all goes back down to that prayer that we can't have this kind of relationship and praying with the Father going into our fourth month. You cannot say that you've been spending time with God and don't have a desire for souls. You can't. I mean, it just don't go together. Something wrong with your prayer. Because that's the number one thing. That's the number one thing to God is souls. Above healing and all of the other stuff that goes on. So that's why we do what we do. And we trying to revamp this thing, and we're going to do everything that we can do, but we can't do the work of the Holy Spirit, but we're going to do everything that God put on our heart to do to motivate you to get involved with soul winning. Would you want to see your brother go to hell, or your sister, or your mother or father? Because that's where your evangelism should start at. Then from there, it branches outside of your house to your neighborhood. And then from there, it branches out to the uttermost parts of the world. But focus on your family, too. When you go to those family gatherings, let them know they need Jesus Christ. Don't be afraid to tell them. Let them know that they need Jesus. And that's what this thing is all about. And this is real serious business. I'm telling you, this is serious. So you're going to hear this more often. And as you begin to cry out as to what this church is doing, what this congregation is doing, we want you to be soul hungry. Hungry for souls. And if you have to come to me and say, Pastor, you know, we need to do more. We're not doing enough. You know, I would eat that up. I would be so enthused and so encouraged. Instead of people coming to you with every other thing on their sun, under the sun about what's going on, well, if they come and say, Pastor, we need to get more souls. We got to find a way that we can reach more souls. Where are our tracks at? Somebody come in there, we don't have that many tracks out there. Where are our tracks at? What are we doing? What do we have in place to reach souls? That will just, I'm going to tell you, that will just tickle me. And it was put a fire under me. Even the more. So let's encourage each other to good works. Amen. I just had to share that real quick. because it just stirred me up. I didn't know which way Linda was going, and I just told her, just follow the Holy Spirit. And I believe that God has spoke to us through her this morning. But we need to just do it, saints. Let's get together. Let's do it. Can we do that? And some people wonder, why don't you call us up to the altar and lay hands on us and say, if you really want to be a soul winner, stand up and all of that stuff. That don't work. How many times we done that? This thing got to be personal between you and God. Not a just commitment or a showing just to say, I came up to the altar and they prayed over me. That's not going to make your interest in souls. What make your interest in soul is when you keep spending time with God and he's going to lay that on your heart and you're going to be excited about soul winning. You're going to be excited about it. So I just needed to say that today. And I know I told you before, don't preach before and don't preach after. But that was an add-on. I had to do that because that's what the Holy Spirit prompted me to do this morning. Amen. Praise God. Let us dismiss. As we dismiss, the elders will be standing down front. So if you need prayer for anything, whatever you need, because of our lack right now of elders, that's because one of them out of town and all of that, if you see the elders being overwhelmed, ministers and deacons, feel free to just step in. If you see that there are more people up here than we can handle, then just come on up and help us to pray. Right after we dismiss, whatever you need, come up here to the altar and we'll pray with you and we'll pray for you. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your servant who have humbled herself, Lord God, and delivered what you had given unto her. We pray that your word fell on good soil. Lord God, we pray for our hearts was wide open to receive it, Lord God. And that we would put it in action, that we would do it, Lord God. Father God, I pray, Lord God, that fire that we have that just smoldering now will be rekindled in us, oh God. And our love for souls, we will be driven. It will be a passion that will just overtake us, that we want to see people come into the kingdom of God. Lord, I pray that we will be a church that just can't rest unless we have told somebody about you, Lord God, that we will not be able to lay our head on our pillow at night and have a good night's sleep if we know we went through that whole day and never shared your love with anybody. Help us to be consumed with this thing, Lord God. So, Father, we just magnify you and we bless you, God. Now, God, we pray that we will be obedient. That we will be obedient to what you have told us to do. Now, may the grace of God, the love of Jesus, and the sweet communion of his Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide in our hearts henceforth now and forever. And this is a very important part that we say every Sunday, but we need to mean it from our heart. We really need to mean this from our heart and not just say it just to be saying it. But when we say it, we need to say it with purpose to encourage each other and to encourage ourselves. So let us say with one voice, with the help of the Holy Spirit, all that the Lord has said, we will do. God bless you and God prosper you in all of your ways. Amen.